times do we get to see Peterson Development?
Good evening, everyone, and welcome to the Planning Commission meeting this February 21st, 2017. We're grateful that you've come out to participate in the public process. Look forward to hearing comments that you have. We have all of the Planning Commissioners present this evening with the exception of Commissioner Quinney, who is excused. We have a rather lengthy agenda tonight. We have an item on our consent calendar, the approval of minutes from February 7th, 2017. Commissioner Sikorski.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Move to approve the minutes as in the staff report.
Second.
We have a motion from Commissioner Sikorski and a second from Commissioner Hansen. Any discussion to the motion? All in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries 6-0. Also, if you're here for item number 8 on the agenda, text amendment infill ordinance, would you please raise your hand? Is there anyone that would like to comment on item number 8? Commissioner Sikorski.
Thank you. Being that we've been asked to allow a little bit more time for this, I'm going to move that we push text amendment agenda item number 8 to the March 7th meeting.
Can I clarify this? If this was noticed as a public hearing, can we open the public hearing and close it so we don't have to have the public hearing on the 7th?
Well, it's going to be... It's
oh, that's true. Nobody could have reviewed it.
Right. So you're right. Okay, never mind.
We have a motion by Commissioner Sikorski. Any second to that motion?
Second.
Thank you. Second by Commissioner Green. Any discussion to that motion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Motion carries 6-0. We just didn't want anyone to have to wait around and then be disappointed if you were here to speak on item number 8. Thank you. Our first public hearing this evening is item number 2 on our agenda, Stone Creek Marketplace, 7800 South, 5600 West, a preliminary development plan. Brandon Peterson is the applicant. Is he present this evening? Please. Thank you, sir. Come on up and present. You'll have up to 10 minutes to present. Thank you.
Thank you. Brandon Peterson with Peterson Development. This is simply a pre-development plan that we've come in for along there on 78th, 56th corner. We're doing the 6 lots, obviously in red. The 2 to the east will be a different submittal. Basically, just in working with the city, we're trying to break these up into 6 potential office/retail type uses, and we've been required to submit lighting plans and potential signage plans and so forth. We've got a 2 or 3 of the pieces somewhat under contract for good uses for the community and the neighborhood, and we look to make it a nice development similar to Kitty Corner, the Highlands, which we were involved with. So, any questions of me?
Any questions for the applicant at this point? Great, thank you. We'll reserve some time for you after the public hearing.
Thank you very much.
Address. Thank you, sir. Mr. McCandless, you have this for city staff?
Thank you. Mr. Chairman, members of the commission, this is, again, a pretty straightforward request. This is part, as I mentioned in our pre-meeting, this is part of the Stone Creek planned community, and it had received concept approval back in 2008. And then as each one of these components of the Stone Creek area develops, they'll come back in for a preliminary plan, and then the final plan would be, or the final development plan would be approved administratively. But this is for preliminary development plan for those 6 lots on the southeast corner, 7800 South and 5600 West. As I mentioned in the findings, we didn't really see any issues with it. It's, what they're proposing is consistent with the plan, and our recommendation would be for approval of the development plan.
Great, thank you. Any questions for Mr. McCandless? Commissioner Green.
So procedurally, just so I'm sure I know, we've already, this area is a zone PC, and they've already done the concept approval, and now we're at the preliminary development plan.
Correct.
Okay. I just wanted to make sure I hadn't missed something in the process.
Thank you. Any other questions for staff? Yes,
just,
please.
Just one other thing. Briefly, I had mentioned in there, I think in your staff reports, that there was an issue with the pylon sign. I think we're working through that. Pylon signs just aren't permitted in that PC district, but they'll just revise. There are other types of signs that I think will work for them, so they'll just revise the development plan when we get the correct signage.
Great, thank you. Anything for staff from the commission?
So if the sign as listed in the development plan doesn't work, do we need to do something as a condition or?
You can if you like, and it would be just as simple as compliance with code requirements.
Great, thank you. Any final questions for staff? Great, well, this was noticed as a public hearing. So let me explain the public hearing process, please. If you would like to speak, you're welcome to come up to the podium. If you could please contain your remarks to 3 minutes or under, you'll hear a buzzer go off. We certainly don't want to curtail any important thoughts and considerations that you have while also wanting to ensure that the process doesn't keep us here unduly to all hours of evening either. So if something is mentioned prior to you and you would still like to speak, if you have something new that you would like to add, please feel free to do so. And or you could simply mention that you also concur with what also has been said before you. With that, we will open up the public hearing if anyone would like to speak on this item. Seeing none, we'll close the public hearing and bring it back for deliberation from the Planning Commission.
Looks like a great fit for the site.
Thank you, Commissioner Luthy and Commissioner Green.
I'm going to move that the Planning Commission approve the preliminary development plan for Stone Creek Marketplace, Clay Hollow Beach, for the property located at approximately 7800 South, 5600 West in the PC zoning district, subject to conditions 1 through 5 in the staff report, plus condition 6, that all signage must be in compliance with the city sign ordinance.
Second.
Thank you. We have a motion from Commissioner Green and a second from Commissioner Sikorski. Any discussion to that motion? All in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries unanimously 6-0. The next item on our agenda is number 3, Don's Meats, 8145 South Redwood Road, conditional use permit. And the applicant is Don Lassiter, correct? Mr. Lassiter, good evening, sir. Please feel free to come and address us.
Thank you very much for this opportunity. Our families have we've been in the meat business for like 60 years, and we've got 3 stores in Davis County now, and we decided to expand south into Salt Lake County, and we have put together a program with Stuart Richardson, his property there at 8145 South Redwood Road, and we've remodeled that store and had all the departments pass off on us and so on and so forth. So we're just happy to come into West Jordan and offer the consumers and the people here in West Jordan a very nice place to shop.
Great. Thank you, sir. Any questions for the applicant? All right. Thank you. If we have any public comments that you'd like to address, we'll reserve some time for you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Gardner.
Mr. Lassiter. Needs a conditional use permit in the city center residential zone, and this use is a conditional use in that zone. He will be moving into half of that building, as you can see outlined on the screen. It's been there for probably 45 years. It started business as a Circle K years and years ago. It's been through various other retail uses. All the parking is already on site. It's the site's been fully developed. You can see this is a front shot of the building. He'll be moving into the south half. He's made, as Mr. Lassiter said, he's made all the building improvements according to building code. He more than meets parking, and staff recommends approval of this conditional use permit with the items of conditions of approval of the staff report.
Great. Thanks, Mr. Gardner. Any questions for Mr. Gardner or other staff on this item?
I'll ask.
Please, Commissioner Green.
Are the parking spaces adequate for retail of this size? Are we okay with that?
Definitely.
Yeah, more than needed, correct, as you mentioned. Great. Wonderful. Anything else? All right. This was also agendized as a public hearing. If you would like to speak on item number 3, we'll now open that public hearing. Seeing none, we'll close the public hearing and bring back a discussion from the Planning Commission. Commissioner Sikorski.
Thank you. Based on the findings set forth in the staff report on evidence presented at the public hearing, move that the Planning Commission approve the conditional use permit for Don's Meats and Grill located at 8145 South Redwood Road in the CCR zone district with the conditions set forth in the staff report.
Second.
We have a motion from Commissioner Sikorski and a second from Commissioner Hansen. Any discussion on that motion?
I have one question.
Wait.
Of course I do. When it refers in condition 1, the hours of operation limited to those indicated on the applicant's narrative, is that, maybe this would be a better question for the city attorney, is that specific enough or is that too vague to say
criteria
applicant's narrative?
Well, we don't have hours of operations established in the CCR zone, and so he's being very specific with the hours he's going to operate. And so he feels, and staff feels like those hours of operation are adequate to mitigate any impacts of either residents.
I'm just wondering if we apply a condition, if it's that vague, if it even matters.
I don't think it's vague at all. I think
he's
laid it out very specifically.
We've got Monday through Thursday, 9 to 6, Friday, Saturday, 9 to 7, store closed Sundays and major holidays.
I just want to make sure we
have specific measurable hours. So
I just want to make sure when the conditions are recorded, we're okay if that's what we've got.
Yeah, and it's consistent with what we've required for other conditional uses, right? So, yeah.
I'm good with it.
Thank you for the clarification. Any other discussion for the motion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Motion carries unanimously 6-0. Thank you for doing business in West Jordan, sir. Brings us to item number 4 on the agenda, Westwood Subdivision, 7904 through 7930 South, 2700 West, preliminary subdivision plat. Growth Aid LLC, Adam Nash is the applicant. Mr. Nash, are you here this evening or your designated representative? No applicant this evening. Growth Aid LLC or Adam Nash. Should we, what do you think, Planning Commission? Should we go right to the staff presentation with Ms. Larson?
Yeah, and then if he shows up, then maybe we could have him address after that point.
Okay. Any other thoughts?
Or we could.
Can you table it?
Always good.
My concern is that there might be people here.
That's what I was just going to ask, is there are people here to address it?
Let's ask the question.
By raise of hand, do we have anyone here to address item number 4, Westwood Subdivision?
Let's table
it. What I would make the motion is we just move it to a later agenda item tonight.
Okay.
There's no one here to speak on it, so.
Great idea. And Mr. Langford, you mentioned that you'll give him a quick call. Thank you. Does that sound all right with everyone? So I move that we up, please, Commissioner Sikorski.
Move that we push this item to the very last on our agenda tonight to give the applicant time to present to us this evening.
I'll second.
Great. Motion by Commissioner Sikorski, second by Commissioner Hatch. Any discussion to that motion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? 6-0. Great. Thank you. So we'll move along to item number 5, Jordan Village Center, lot number 5, easy rent to own, 2573 West, 7800 South, a preliminary site plan and an SC1 zone. Diversified Design Services, Brandon Lundeen is the applicant. Mr. Lundin, please come forward.
Good evening. I'm Brandon with Diversified Design Services.
I'll introduce myself. My name is Greg Wall, and I'm with the development company, Leading Tech Development.
Thank you.
What we're proposing to build is that's the final vacant lot of that development that's been there. It's been vacant for quite a few years. We're looking to just come in and put in a small strip center with easy rent to own to be the base occupant, and then have three additional lease spaces to the north end that's pretty much similar to what's there on the site now with the other developments.
Great. Any questions for the applicant? All right, we'll reserve some time for you if there's public comment that you'd like to address.
Thank you.
Thank you. Ms. Larson, you have this item?
I do, thank you. So the proposal is for a preliminary site plan for the property located at 2573 West, 7800 South, located in an SC1 zoning district. The site is actually a pad site that was originally approved with Jordan Village development as lot 5 in the phase 3 development. This approval, and it did receive approval earlier from Planning Commission for preliminary and final site plan with 12 conditions that are included in the staff report. Because this site, the lot 5 wasn't developed within the time frame that it was approved in, it was expired, so the applicant is required to go through the preliminary and final site plan review again. Even still, the original conditions that were approved during Jordan Village approval, the site will be able to meet all 12 of those conditions. Staff is recommending that the new proposal is approved by the Planning Commission for a preliminary site plan with the 5 conditions listed in the staff report.
Thank you, Ms. Larson. Any questions for staff?
I'll wait.
Let's open the public hearing portion for item number 5. Anyone who would like to speak to this matter? Everyone's comfortable in their chairs. We'll close the public hearing on this item, bring it back to the Planning Commission for discussion. Commissioner Sikorski.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I think that since this is something that we've heard already and it's back before us again based solely on an expiration of the item, I'd like to go ahead and move that we approve the Jordan Village Easy Rent Own preliminary site plan for property located at 2573 West, 7800 South, in an SC1 zoning district with the conditions set forth in the staff report.
Thank you. Do we have a second to the motion?
I'll second.
We have a motion by Commissioner Sikorski and a second by Commissioner Hatch. Any discussion to the motion?
I guess my only question, I could have asked it before, but the previous conditions included some general language on landscaping for water conservation and a couple of those kind of things, and they're not in the new conditions. Is there any reason why we're doing that? If we don't do that anymore?
I think it's just different ways that staff write their staff reports to the Planning Commission. All of the conditions, all 12 of the conditions that were originally approved are all conditions, all requirements found in the city code. So through our red line comments, staff make sure that all of these 12 conditions are met as a typical staff review of the site plan.
Okay.
Thank you. Commissioner Sikorski.
Thank you. I think it's also important to note that the city code for landscaping was revised. I'm not going to say a date because I don't know specifically, but I know it was revised not too long ago to include a lot of the requirements that were in this staff report.
Thank you. From a Okay, so all in favor of the motion, say aye.
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 Any opposed? All right, motion carries 6-0 unanimously. Which brings us to item number 6 on our agenda this evening, Trimble Manor, 9191 South, 1150 West, preliminary subdivision plat, 34 lots on 15.019 acres in an R1 12G zone. Wright Development Group, Phil Holland is the applicant. Please, thank you.
Thank you very much. You know, the staff report did an excellent job of describing our proposed community. You know, one thing is we look at some of these infill opportunities, which we think that this is. You know, the first thing we look at is, are we consistent with that general plan, and are we consistent with what we are proposing, meeting the zoning requirements? And we are also aware of the conditions in the staff report and agree that we will meet those. Maybe if I just point out one item, 1150 West, I don't know if there's a map as part of this proposal. You can see it there. A couple of things that we reviewed as we were looking at the connectivity of this project was, should 1150 West connect into the project? And I think as the developer and as we met with staff on several occasions, the thought was we don't want to disrupt how 1150 is currently. And so as part of our proposal, our new community, Trimble Manor, does not connect to 1150 West. But we do provide a road that keeps coming down for future fire protection and access. And so there will not be any full access on 1150 from our project. Having said that, there are three stub roads into the project, so we do feel that we have maintained that connectivity and look forward to a great community here in West Jordan.
Great, thank you. Any questions for the applicant? We'll reserve some time for you after public comments.
Yes.
Thank you. Mr. Forsyth, you have this for city staff?
Yeah, thank you, Chairman. So the applicant did a good job of describing some of the connectivity, so I'll just add to some of the general lots and the design of the subdivision. But what they plan to do is the subject site consists of five different parcels that they'll be dividing into 34 lots with an overall density of 2.7 dwelling units per acre. So the zone that it's located in is the R112G zone, which is a single family residential zone requiring 3,800 square foot homes. So these are some of the larger homes that we see in the city and will be pretty similar to those found in the surrounding neighborhood. So most of the surrounding area is also within that same R112 zone, particularly to the east and to the west and a little bit to the south. To the north is an agricultural zone, most of which are single-family residential properties. So the R112G zone does require a minimum lot size of 12,000 square feet, 13,000 square feet for corner lots. And the applicant's done a good job in meeting that. All of the lots within the subdivision meet those minimum requirements. Pretty much all the lots, as you can see from the subdivision plat, are square or rectangle lots, which should allow for maximum amount of efficiency in building space. And so we really don't see a whole lot of issues with that. Now you'll notice lot 127 down at the end of the cul-de-sac there. We did look at that to make sure a G-size home would fit on that lot, and it looks like it will. They'll have about depth-wise 48 feet between the front setback and the rear setback. So judging by the width of that lot, there should be plenty of room to fit that size of a home on that lot. So, as the applicant stated, they've got 3 points of connectivity, both the east, south, and the west, so we feel that that will allow for good traffic flow and good connectivity through the neighborhood. So, there's only one cul-de-sac proposed, as I pointed out earlier. That's the length of that is about 430 feet long, which meets our maximum of 450 feet. So they're well within that requirement. As for other requirements, the only other one that is worth mentioning, other than utilities and some of the stormwater, boundary wall is required on the north boundary, simply because there's an agriculture zone to the north, and whenever there's different zones, different uses, we do require a boundary wall there that's 6 feet tall and composed of some sort of a masonry material. So the applicant is proposing that. You can see here, those are some of the existing walls that are both on the east boundary and the west boundary. The applicant is proposing something virtually identical to that. So based on these findings and those explained in the staff report, staff is recommending that the Planning Commission grant approval of the preliminary subdivision plat for Trimble Manor located at 9191 South, 1150 West, with the conditions of approval listed in the staff report.
Thank you, Mr. Forsyth. Any questions for staff and the commission?
Yeah. So 1150 West, we're not dealing with in this project.
Correct. The plan is to leave that as is, and that will simply run into that the road running east to west there. Now, the end of that road, you can't really see it on the plan here, but they do have it labeled that they'll be putting bollards there to block off any cross traffic or people cutting through that area.
Okay, but so long term, if we look at the future land use map, that the area that's on 1150 West will eventually be PO.
Correct.
So yeah. At some point in time, when the property sold, are we going to allow 1150 to go into this neighborhood? Is that a possibility?
I don't believe that's the intent, but we would probably address it at that point.
Okay.
Great, thank you. Any other questions for staff? Seeing none, we'll open the public comment section. We've had a number of... I apologize. Commissioner Hanson, you had a...
No, I'll wait until after the public.
Okay, thank you. I apologize. I need to look at my button. They're not gumdrops. We'll open the public comment section. We have a plethora of people who have already signed up to speak, so we want to honor their place in line. Jeff Markins, I apologize. I might not have the correct last... Jeff.
Yeah, I think he knows who we're talking about.
Jeff M.
Well, that's an H.
Oh, Jeff H.
Jeff Hopkins.
So. Thank you.
Cousinship.
Can you please state your name and address for the record? Please?
It is Jeff Hopkins of 1063 Albion View Circle in the River Oaks Estate Community, which is east of the proposed new subdivision.
Thank you.
So as a concern we have down there at the River Oaks Estates neighborhood with the new subdivision is obviously the stormwater, any land drain issues that might occur that would bring that water downhill into our subdivision. And our concern is any potential impacts that it would have on the subdivision. I will note that we have spoken with the West Jordan Engineering, and we've had meetings on it, and we'll continue to stay engaged with them. But to go on record, we have those concerns, and would like to make sure that those items are addressed
before it's finalized and completed.
Thank you. We'll address those this evening. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Mr. John Coleman.
Hi, I'm John Coleman. I live at 9278 South Hidden Peak, which is like three lots below the wall on the east side. And I want to echo the same thing. We've had water problems. Almost everybody in the city knows. As soon as you go talking to the planning commission or anybody, they know who this. They know our neighborhood. They know we've had water problems in there. And you're planning on putting a retention pond right where they can't drain the lot. They dug down 3 feet and it filled up full water. I'm not saying I don't want this to happen. You got to do your homework for this or we're going to have a mess. Because you're going to park that on top of something that never dries out. The other thing I want to make note of, I didn't see anything in it. There's a spring on this property that has not been mentioned. And somebody needs to deal with that. There's a berm along that long wall there. And there's a spring along there that drains through us, through River Oaks. And there's nothing on this that I saw about that spring. That's going to have to be capped and dealt with properly, and that's going to be in one of those pieces of property. So those are the key things I want to talk about and bring to your attention so that they can be dealt with.
Great. Thank you, Mr. Coleman. Appreciate that. Next, we have Barry Tonderold.
Hi, Barry Tondebold, 9313 Hidden Peak Drive. I just want to piggyback on some of our interests in the potential water issues there. In particular, I'm interested in how the stormwater from that subdivision is going to be dealt with and where that's going. We're downhill from there, so obviously it has to come through our subdivision somehow. And if it is to piggyback into the existing storm drains that we have in that subdivision, we have a retention basin in Hidden Peaks. And I'm extra interested because that retention basin is actually in my backyard. So I don't want to see any additional water come into there as a result of this new development. There have been a couple times, I mean, we get water in there consistently a few times a year when we have these big thunderstorms in the summer. And I have seen the pipe coming into the retention pond almost at capacity. So adding another subdivision about the same size, you know, approximately, I think will have an impact if that's our intention and if nothing else is done to move that water elsewhere. So, just for the record.
Great. Thank you, Mr. Conroll. Next we have Greg Nadel.
My name is Greg Nadel. I live at 9269 Hidden Peak Drive, so a couple houses down from Barry. three things I wanted to talk about. I don't know if this is a pointer or... Mm-hmm. I live about right here, and I've got riprap that goes through my yard. We've got this pond back here. The primary source of water for this pond comes the north of Alpine Ridge Circle, comes down Hidden Peak and goes into the pond. This lot right here, when they moved the spring water into the foundation drain, we calculated that they've moved about 5,000 to 10,000 gallons an hour into our foundation drain that comes down the north of, or the south of Alpine Ridge Circle. When that water went into our foundation drains here, we noticed a serious drop in the pond back here. So I'm suggesting that in part of the planning process and review process that we're adding additional water collection infrastructure up here that care be taken, that we don't need this to go dry, which is, I feel like that'd be kind of a eyesore and a smell, bugs. I don't know what that would turn into, but I feel like somebody should at least take that into consideration there. A little more color on this lot right here. Like I said, we've calculated that is 5,000 to 10,000 gallons an hour. So if you start breaking this lens right here to get into here, you're going to be into that kind of water again. when this actually drains into our foundation drains, and we've tried to figure out from the as-builts where that water goes today, and we can't find it. It should be coming through through some pipe down here on John's yard, but it's not coming through there. So we've actually talked to Nate Nelson and asked for some assistance in trying to get a camera in there to help us figure out, since the as-builts are not correct. So just a little extra color on that whole neighborhood there and why we kind of have some concerns. This is Barry's yard back here. He's got, right there is where Barry was, and he's got that overflow drain right there. One last thing I want to point out is, even though there's 3 points of access out of this subdivision, we believe that most of the traffic is going to be going up Hidden Peak Drive here so they can go towards I-15. We've noted when all the residents are parking on Hidden Peak Drive right here, that road isn't wide enough for 2 lanes of traffic, so forth. And it gets kind of dicey in there in the winter. So if we're adding all that traffic going back out on Hidden Peak Drive, I would request that we take that into consideration as well.
Thank you, Mr. Needle. Next, we have Art Segan. Did I say that correctly, sir?
My name is Art Segan, and I reside at 1062 West Alpine Ridge Circle. My wife is here as well. We're also residents of the River Oaks subdivision, and our lot is adjacent to this proposed subdivision as well. And we have one main concern.
Guess what that is? Water.
We have experienced some difficulty with the water issues there, and as was stated before, the lot behind us, the Trimble Farm, is pretty highly sloped, and so the water has nowhere else to go but into our subdivision. And as I said, we've had some minor issues, but you know, we have a house that has a basement. That lots on either side of us do not. But we are concerned about the drainage of the water off of this lot, as well as some of the other concerns. There's a fair amount of wildlife that resides in that area right now. Deer, raccoons, bats, eagles, hawks, and a number of other species that would be decimated, obviously, when a subdivision is built. I'd like to echo what Greg just said in regard to the traffic. If we're not going to access this from 1150 West, the other remaining routes of ingress and egress are going to take on way more traffic than they were originally intended to take. But the main concern, obviously, is the water issues, which we have seen cause some problems in our subdivision already. And we just want to make sure that these considerations are taken into account and that the hydrologic engineering is performed in a competent and reasonable way. If there is a problem, if we have water in our basement as a result of this, you know, I'm going to want to know who to sue, and I will. So that's all I want to say. Thank you.
Great. Thank you, Mr. Segman. Next, we have Mr. Kevin Davis.
Hi, good evening. I'm Kevin Davis. I reside at 1058 Albion View Circle. And I'd like to concur with everything that has been said so far about the water problems and the traffic problems and the wildlife. And I'd like to add one additional thought, which is it's fantastic that these are slated to be 3,800 square foot homes. But as we all know, there are many different ways to build a 3,800 square foot home. And the homes in the River Oaks Estates subdivision are all held to a standard through our CC&Rs enforced by the HOA to have all brick or stone exteriors. And so I'd like to see similar CC&Rs enforced in this new subdivision so that we help to keep the value of the homes that are existing there, and we don't just have 3,800 square foot homes that don't have any sort of minimum standards that they have to build to.
Very good, thank you.
Thank you.
Great, that's all that we have had that have signed up in advance. And please note that if you would like to speak, we certainly don't want to dissuade you from doing so, but please know that we will definitely be addressing this evening stormwater, drainage, traffic, wildlife, the preliminary subdivision plat. So if you would still like to speak on item number 6, please feel free to do so at this time. Please, sir. Please state your name and address for the record.
My name is Spencer Hine. I live at 1102 Trimble Creek Drive. I can run this thing. If you'll go to the next plot that shows all the different, my property, if I can find it, is right here. The property next to me is vacant right now. They proposed the road to come in here and come in here. My concern is this piece of property right here. And I cannot tell what this says. And if that's going to be a holding tank or something for water?
It's a detention pond.
A detention pond?
Yeah.
Is that going to be... If you can get to that picture again. Here's your road. Here's the, I guess you're calling this whole section here a green grass or something?
Yeah, so one of the conditions of approval is to have that area landscaped. So
it'll be landscaped?
Yeah.
Okay, the holding pond will be here?
Correct.
How large is that pond? Their main concern is that property down below, which he wasn't able to build on because he couldn't put in a basement. That holding pond is right above that. My concern is who will take care of this? Will the city or will the developer?
I believe the plan is to have the property owner.
The property owner will take care of that, this area. Will that area there be from the road itself, which comes in from the gated community, which is over here? That road is coming in from the gated community here. You're proposing that this will all be landscaped from here to here. The properties will start approximately there, which this is the problem down below now. There'll be a holding pond here, but this will all be landscaped. True?
That's what it says in the condition.
Can that be changed down the road?
If it's in the condition of the staff report, then for them to be able to move ahead, then
it'll have to come to another committee?
No, it has to be done.
I know there's great concern about the water. I know there is. Being above, we don't have that concern because I would imagine all of our groundwater goes down into that subdivision. And for them to be able to accomplish the water problem for all these houses, all these properties here, is going to be a big challenge. And that's what's got to be more concerned than anything with you and you, especially. Thank you.
Thank you. Would anyone else like to speak on this item? Please come forward. Please remember to state your name and address.
Yeah, name is Carl Brewer. Address is 9228 South Trimble Creek. So I'm fairly close to the southern entrance to the proposed property. And my question was mostly about the retention pond. It does look like it was intended to be landscaped. And I'm curious if there was any thought put into possibly making that a public area for the community, at least grassed over to be a play area, or potentially even to put some play equipment to kind of revitalize for younger families the entire community. It'd be a real boon to the community, those of us existing, and also the new houses, if we could have something like that.
Thank you. We'll discuss that tonight. Yeah. Appreciate that. I saw another hand. Please come forward.
Good evening. My name is Rebecca Delgarian, and I live at 1473 Brigadoon Park Drive, and it is actually not on your plot, but I am connected to this neighborhood just via our ward boundaries, and I would like to add a little positivity to tonight's meeting. I know water is a big issue, and I'm not going to overlook that by any means. I think that there's great planning that can be done to hopefully resolve that issue, because I, for one, am excited about this development. I'd like to have a place where I can move from one side of the neighborhood to the other to be among these amazing, amazing neighbors that have all spoken tonight. I'm appreciative of their concerns, and I'm grateful for the Trimble family. I know some of the children are here that are actually offering up this land for this development. I did have one comment based on somebody who had mentioned that they hope that this new development has similar requirements for basically exterior. And I just wanted to mention that they've said brick and masonry and exterior. I just wanted to mention that their neighborhood is a beautiful neighborhood, and it's represented what that style was at the time. And I would hope that it would be considered to not be the only exception. I think there's a lot of advances in exteriors with hardy board and different things that might not necessarily be exterior that consists of tons of masonry. And as it develops, I hope that they can take that into consideration, that we don't necessarily, as a prospective buyer in this neighborhood, wouldn't want to be tied to something like that, but I would like a standard to be set. Anyway, appreciate your time. Thank you.
Thank you. Appreciate your comments. Please, sir.
My name is David Trimble, and I currently reside in Sandy, Utah. I'll speak briefly in behalf of our family. We've owned this property since 1959. We've always cherished the property and felt like it was one of the most beautiful spots in the entire city. And we didn't come to the decision lightly to finally sell this last remaining piece, but we have gotten to the point where obviously farming it is not a very lucrative matter anymore. And we lost our parents a few years ago, but we've continued to maintain the property and hopefully keep it in a nice appearance. But I think we've reached the stage where that doesn't make a lot of sense for the family anymore, and certain people that took good care of it have moved away. So we have always kind of held back this last piece because we thought it had some terrific potential. Many of the neighbors here that have spoken also live on property that we used to own. Everything from our property that's under consideration to the river was once ours as well. And we've taken great pride that these neighborhoods have been developed in a very outstanding way. We feel like we're proud of what's there today, and that it's a bonus to the community of West Jordan. So we've tried to do all we can to make sure that this last piece gets developed in the same way, with beautiful houses that people will enjoy, that the neighborhood will be enhanced. Two of my sisters live in the neighborhood, so they're very invested that this remain a very upscale, wonderful place to live. So it's always been zoned to be property. We hope that it can continue to be an upscale neighborhood where people are proud to live. And otherwise, we quite frankly don't know what we do with it. It's sitting there, and obviously it's not really at all viable to farm anymore. So hopefully these issues can be worked out, as they have been in the past, as the other pieces of this property have been developed.
Great. Thank you, Mr. Trimble. Anyone else who would like to speak? Please come forward.
Yeah, I feel real not
could adequate. Could you please state your name and address, please, sir?
Okay, I just feel pretty inadequate speaking after Mr. Trimble, but my name is Ryan Riley. I live at 9172 Hidden Peak Drive. I don't have anything to say that hasn't been said, but maybe just a little bit of more of an exclamation point. One of the things that I'm worried about, it has been mentioned that ingress egress off of 90th, we've got the River Oaks Apartments right here. It's perfectly legal for everybody to line up their trucks right along this curb, which they do. And then they line them up along the west side of the curb. It's been said that it literally is a one-way corridor through there. So, you know, I mean, the traffic engineers can figure it out, but being that this is the closest, I mean, I would venture to guess that this little stub out right here would get most of the traffic. 34 homes, you know, conservative estimate, 68 cars or so. And it's something. It's a bit of a mess there. And then just to echo, I appreciate hearing Mr. Trimble talk about, you know, the upscale manner, because that they want to have it developed, because the rest of the area is what brought myself to the area. I'm just a little concerned. I went to the planning office today and asked if there were any CCNRs in place or any sort of covenants about building or building standards, and I was told that there wasn't. So seems like an extension of the neighborhoods that surround it, and so I would like to see it cohesive. Thank you.
Great, thank you, and we'll definitely discuss that this evening. Saw a few more hands. If anyone would like to speak, please come forward. Please don't be nervous. We're grateful to hear what you have to say.
You know, my name is Janice Ray, and I live at 9315 Avignon Place, and I'm in the gated area. We have, like they've mentioned before, a lot of wildlife. The wildlife are out there in the winter, and they're looking for berries that drop off the trees. Cars come up there much too fast. They can't miss the ducks. Then we have the eggs hatched, and all the little ducklings go. And they're going across the street. What's across the street? I don't know, but they got to go over there. So that's one of my concerns. But my biggest concern is where the cars are going to come out. I think I heard him say they would not come out on Trimble Lane. I hope that's the case. When I moved there 15 years ago, that was a dead-end street, and it was heavenly. But then they opened it up to all of those beautiful homes down below. That's fine, but we now have all of that traffic. If you open that up to traffic, I don't think we'll ever get out of the subdivision. We'll just be sitting there all day trying to get out. It would be very nice if we could make sure they're not going to have a connection to Trimble Lane. I don't know if you know right where the gated community is. I can't see it on that myself. But we come right out where that point is, the closest to where we are. There's not very much space in between there, and that's the road. And so I'm nervous, and I hope I said it okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you. We appreciate your comments. Please, sir.
My name is Larry Bradshaw. I live at 1192 Trimble Lane. One of the things that I would hope that the city would take into consideration is that additional traffic coming onto 90th South at a 1150 West, or 1075 West, I suppose. And that is a dangerous place already. You really ought to give some consideration to putting a light there to control traffic exiting this subdivision and those people coming out of 1075 West from the north entering onto 90th South. There are quite a few near accidents there, very dangerous, so give that some consideration if you would. One of the things that I think a lot of the people are concerned about, in addition to being water, that we have seen, in my personal opinion, a lack of performance on the part of the city in following through on Trimble Estates, phase two. This is the Michelson Way, which on that map is the one that would be running due west off of this site. That subdivision was one that was, I don't think it was really watched over by the city. To this date, the subdivision drainage is still not completed. The detention basin on there in there was supposed to have been controlled by a homeowners association, and the city allowed that bond to be released, and no homeowners association was in place, and that detention basin right across the street from where this intersection goes east through this development is a weed patch all summer long, and no one cares for it. The neighbors have gotten together occasionally and cut the weeds in there, But it just seems that some of the concerns we have is are caused by the city really not following through. The stone fence around this subdivision was never finished. It was never stained. It just looks bad. And I would hope that the city would do a little bit better job of controlling, especially holding on to the bond until all the work is in place. And we know that it's going to be a subdivision which we can all be proud of and not one that everyone has to worry about whether the city's going to do their job. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Anyone else this evening on this item? Three more hands, please. Ladies first.
My name is Susan Seguin, and I live at 1062 West Alpine Ridge Circle. And I just wanted to, you know, reiterate some of the things that people said about the water. For me, I'm extremely worried about the water situation just because everything behind us seems like it's a real delicate balance. And we have already experienced issues with our fence having to be taken down, trees been taken out to research the water issues that are caused in that area by the lot next to us, which somebody tried to build on, which was not successful. I don't really know what's going on with that lot now, but it was difficult for us because we had big mud piles next to us, and so I'm concerned about that. And like my husband said, we are the only ones in between those two lots that have a basement. We've never had any issues, no insurance claims, and I want to keep it that way. Another thing that people were saying about the traffic there at 90th South is it is extremely dangerous the way it is. I called the city to ask if we could make that a no parking area on the east side of, I think it is 1075 West. And I was told we couldn't do that because the apartments needed parking spaces, but they could put up signs that they couldn't park from the corner to a certain area. And it's a little bit better, but it's still dangerous because you can't see the people coming out from the apartments. If they could at least make it all no parking from the south end of that east side of those apartments, that would help a lot because you just can't see people come out there. It's dangerous. And I've had people almost hit me head on, like the gentleman said over here, coming from the north side of 90th South. And so if that did happen, I would like to see a light put at that intersection as well. And then just a little side note, it will be very disappointing to lose all the wildlife at that site. And I wish that maybe that site could have been done something else, maybe a park or something that the city could buy. But also, I'm worried as well as the gentleman said about that retention basin, because the one that he is speaking of, it is, they're not weeds in that retention basin, they're trees in there. So anyway, that's it. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you for your comments. Anyone else this evening, especially if you have new information to interject, because we'll certainly be addressing every one of these items that have already been identified.
There's one other thing. By the apartments, there's actually a wall.
Sorry, would you restate your name?
John Coleman, 9278 South Hidden Peak. There's actually a wall, so when they're trying to get out of that, there's a 7-foot-high wall heading toward the apartments that they'll have to look around also. So that's going to have to be dealt with somehow.
Great. Taken thank down. You. Thank you. Please, sir.
Merlin Harrison, I live at 1187 West, right on 90th South. And first off, is this going to be a homeowners association?
We haven't really discussed that yet. Todd, do you know if HOA? Are they establishing an HOA?
I'm not currently aware of an HOA being established. One of the purposes of locating the detention pond on a lot is to avoid an HOA. I would have to be told otherwise if there's an HOA in this.
Yeah, I'd like you to talk about that.
Okay. If this is a in a homeowners association, then we have to have right development provide something on the right-of-way agreement that was done in the 20th of April in 1964. There's an agreement which recorded with the county on an easement on 1150 West. And that agreement has to be taken care of in one way or another. Either the developer or the Trimbles have got to extend that agreement, and that'll go as long as that property is there, unless they develop it and turn it over to the city, because it's an ongoing agreement. I can read you part of the agreement, and the Trimbles are responsible for their heirs, their assigns, and everything to carry that out, and that goes out to 90th South. And when they dead-end that thing, the road there, back on the property, when they dead-end 1150 West, there's no turnaround. We've talked to the fire department, and they can't turn a fire truck around there. If they dead-end 1150 West, there's no outlet. So there's in the easement there, if it's in the HOA situation, then we've got to have that settled before we can agree with any building that goes on down there, because they're to stand one third of the cost of repair, maintenance, and everything on 1150 West. And if they block it off and just move away from it, we've been 53 years putting up with that easement, and now they're just going to walk away. That's not going to be fair for the landowners along 1150 West.
And we will address that, sir. Thank you for bringing it up.
So, is there going to be an overflow on the retention basin?
And we'll be speaking about that as well.
Because there has to be, because we get the irrigation water down from the South George Canal. And sometimes that water will run for 3 or 4 days down there. And if nobody's taking care of it, that retention basin ain't going to hold. These other people's going to get washed out. And they do need a light there at 1075 West.
We'll be addressing that too. Thank you.
So that's part of it. And but this, you've got to look into this agreement. I've got a copy of the agreement if you want to see it.
Great. Thank you. Yes, if you could leave it with Mr. Langford, that would be informational. We appreciate that. We'll make sure it gets back to you.
And it states right here in the agreement that the cost of said improvements and care, maintenance, and repair thereof from that time forward shall be shared as follows. One third of said cost shall be paid by Cuthbert J. Trimble and Eileen Trimble, his wife, their heirs, executors, administrators, or assigns. So that goes on for, well, it's been there for 52 years now. It might be for another 52.
Great, thank you. And we'll have Mr. Langford and Mr. Murray check that out.
Can you just take a copy of that and have it back or no? Okay.
Yes, we'll get that back to you, sir. Thank you.
All right.
Great. Does anyone else have anything new to interject tonight? Again, if it's especially new material, we'll already be addressing everything that's been addressed. We don't want to dissuade you from speaking, but we'd also like to move it along.
My name is Kay Ryan. I live at 9053 South, 1150 West, right on 1150 West Street. And Merlin did bring this up, but I heard somebody say that they were going to put some bollards or something up so that traffic can go through there. But my question was the same as his. Can garbage trucks and other things get around there? Because we have a hard time getting garbage service down that lane until we could show that we could turn a truck around. And I know it's required for fire and other emergencies. That's all I have.
Great, thank you. Good point. Any other comments this evening? Seeing none, we'll close the public comment session and bring it back to the commission. We're going to allow Mr. Holland to come back up and address any of these issues if he would like. And I propose, if it's amenable to the Planning Commission, it might be good to have a hybrid of a little bit of back and forth clarification with staff as Mr. Holland is addressing an issue by issue, so we don't rehash them since we have a lot of. Is that amenable?
Yes, we have to suspend the rules.
Is that a rule suspension?
Yeah, it'd probably be the best to just have somebody make that procedural motion.
Move to suspend the rules.
Second.
Great. We have a motion by Commissioner Sikorski, a second by Commissioner Green. Any discussion of that motion? All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Motion carries 6-0. So what we'll do is we'll take this one by one, and please, if I miss anything, let me know. We want to make sure that we respect all of the public comment that's been made and we address every issue. So we'll have a little bit of back and forth according to whichever respective staff member is tasked with that specific area. Let's talk water first. So, Mr. Holland, would you like to address anything regarding a water detention pond?
Those are two issues.
That's true. That's very true.
And one is the spring/irrigation water.
Very good, Commissioner Luthy. Thank you. So let's talk about water first, and then we'll do the detention pond irrigation.
So first the spring. Is that what we're talking about? Or
yes.
Yes.
Now, is there a spring? Nobody knows for sure. What we do know from our soils report that there is standing water in this area that's been field runoff for a long time. Historically, I've got maps from, the 1940s. Historically, there has been water in this area right here, off of this subdivision. And so I think that having said that, now we go into the other part, which is the water that we're bringing to the situation. The beauty of it is we're not adding water to the situation. We don't just add some water. This water is already on the site. And so what our objective is part of the improvements that we'll do on site, is to make sure that that water is metered and goes to a specific place. Now, if I weren't here today with Trimble Manor as it's proposed, the residents of River Oaks Estates would still have water issues. Now, as we have met with city engineering four times, it's definitely something that is in the forefront of what we're doing technically with staff. And we think, and we've also met with the Homeowners Association as well, we think that we can solve our problem, which is collect the water that's there. Now that we have roads, we have inlet boxes, now we know where the water goes, and we can control that. Having done all that, we can also improve River Oaks Estates, some of their concerns. And you've had a couple of residents talk to you about, I think, some of these residents right here, and they have valid concerns. Right now, they have no idea where that water goes that used to be here. As part of what we are saying to staff, and I think that they're on board, and I think that some of the HOA representatives are also on board, that it's almost like, let's kill two birds with one stone. And there's something important to say about detention. We are required by cities here in the state of Utah to have a detention pond in the event of a 100-year flood. And so when we develop a site, we have to do it per engineering requirements. It's not a standing pond or a pond that, you know, you could go skip rocks in with your kid. It's not that type of a pond. This is in the event of a 100-year flood, that it would meter itself out into the city's storm drain system. And so we are taking what is currently, in my opinion, a D minus and taking it to potentially an A. And so we feel like we're solving these issues. But when, you know, a development comes, you have to ask every question that they've asked. You have to do that. And so I completely agree with them having the concerns. But my thought is that we are resolving these issues with this new development.
Correct. Thank you, Mr. Johnson. Anything that you want to add to that?
No, I think this has been great thus far. There are two separate issues. We have the storm drain issue as well as the groundwater issue. One potential option is to combine those, but the final design has not yet been completed, so we have not yet conducted a review from the engineering department.
Great, thank you, which is another thing we probably should have brought up a little earlier with public comment. We're talking about a preliminary subdivision plat here, and there's going to be other phases that we're going to see. Commissioner Sikorski.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And like you were just beginning to say, I'd probably cut you off. The process is that once this is approved, all of the plan has to go through city engineering. It all has to be seen by hydrologists. It all has to be run through all of the code requirements. So it's not going to be, this isn't going to be something that we just kind of throw together. Has to meet minimum standards before it can be passed and developed.
Commissioner Hanson.
Thank you. One thing I'm really grateful that is an R1 Clark D. We don't see those that often. And so I am pleased that that is what you're looking at. But I am concerned about the water. The city has gone to a great expense and a great length of time and labor to take care of a water problem on the west side of 7800 South. It's still going on. We can't allow a development that is going to go in and all of a sudden people have got water in their basements, or if we get a 100-year rainfall, that it's in their living rooms. So this detention pond, I don't know that it's going to be able to take care of the water. Water flows downward. This is downhill. And that does bother me, the size of the detention pond, due to the fact that the city has had water problems and has been to a great extent of money to get that fixed. And so this would fall back on you before we could ever approve this to make sure that that is not what these people are going to deal with. Trimble Creek and all of them are exceptionally nice neighborhoods, nice housing. I would hate to see people put that kind of money into something and have water problems within a couple of years of finishing the home. So that is my main concern, is this water problem. If we could do the spring and the detention pond, that would be great. But I don't know the detention pond is going to be large enough to handle the water. You say the people to the north have always got water. And so, again, that is going to go into this detention pond. So that is my main concern, is the size of the detention pond and if it can handle the overflow. Thank you.
Great, thank you. Let's take two more commissioner comments, and then please feel free to add any more information you'd like on this item. Commissioner Luthy.
Yeah, so I heard a couple phrases passed around, and I just want to make sure I understand what's going on. So the spring, we talked about being located near where the new detention base is going, but I also heard something about irrigation water. Is that the case as well, that there is irrigation water on the site?
So as part of its existing and pre-existing use, there has been irrigation on this site. The irrigation has not been going for, I think, months. And of course.
And this is like a secondary canal type water.
Well, that's
right.
This is somebody else said that.
Sure. I'm just trying to get my mind wrapped around. Are we talking about that's what's causing the water, or are we talking about something where it's the groundwater itself is now reached an elevation where it's coming out?
So we've said the word spring a couple of times.
Correct.
So let me clarify. I don't think anybody technically knows if there is a spring. There's groundwater in the area, and that's safe to say. And a lot of that groundwater, because I have a geotechnical report that shows that there's not a lot of groundwater in this area. Now, there certainly is some standing water here that's been there for a long time. Historically, there has been surface water in this area right here. So you can conclude quite a few things from that, like I said before, River Oaks Estates has had water issues. My site, as it currently sits, has surface runoff and has irrigation, which will be cut off. And we will channel all these things in control.
Can you show me where that's at on that map?
Which one?
The irrigation water. Where is it running on the site?
The entire site. So there's...
is there a canal?
There's all sorts of canals on the site, but they are not active, and they've been closed off for months.
That's historical farming.
Canals. Right.
I might just add, we've been flooding and down that hill for 50 years, so that's a lot of water.
Okay.
So
once that's gone, of course, that makes some differences. So that's why I want to understand exactly what we're talking about here. Are we talking about something that's rising up, or are we talking about something
real quickly,
before we lose control here, let's please just keep it one person speaking at a time, and that would have to be the person at the podium. Thank you.
That was Mr. Trimble that would know better than me. He's seen that over a 50-year period.
Great. Thank you. Anything else on the first part of the water item? Great. Let's talk about the detention pond then. Would you like to speak? Oh, I'm sorry. Commissioner Skoski, did you have
anything? It was actually more in line with the detention pond, so that works out. Great.
Before you move to the detention pond, I'm looking at the staff report, and it talks about the stormwater lines are going to flow into the detention pond. And then they're going to tie into a new line running along Alpine Ridge Circle to an existing line. Mm-hmm. So the developer's going to have to put, is he putting in that new line on Alpine Ridge Circle, or is the city doing that?
Currently, as proposed, yes, it would be the developer placing that new line.
Okay. And is that line, based on your assessment, what size line are we going to put in there? Is it going to be big? Are we going to go from big to small, from Alpine Ridge to Hidden Peak, or what are we going to do?
The line size has not yet been designed. That will come in at final. However, we would never have a situation where we have a large line connecting to a smaller one.
Do we know what the capacity? I'm going to sound like a freaking engineer, Commissioner Moody.
Yes.
Do we have any idea what the current capacity and flow on that Hidden Peak line is?
Not currently. That would be a part of the analysis required as part of the subdivision.
Okay.
Now, if I can, Mr. Green, if I can just touch on that. These are things that we're well aware of and working with staff to make sure that we have an understanding of what's going on. This isn't going to bite us. Whoops, we didn't figure this out. We've done extensive research, and bless their hearts, West Jordan Engineering Department is tough. And every developer in the state would tell you that.
No disrespect, but I'm sure the developer told us the same thing about 7800 South and 3200 West, too. So,
hey, may I just interject, though?
Commissioner Skoski.
Yeah.
There are minimum standard requirements that have to be met before a subdivision can be built, period. It's non-negotiable. So a big line to a small line would never happen. It's a minimum standard requirement. In design, it's not going to happen. So let me just say that when a plan is put forth to the city engineers, they're going to review it, and it's going to meet those minimum requirements. I have to deal with code in my profession all the time, and code requirements are the bottom end of standard. So it's not going to... I have a hard time with this because I feel like right now it it's kind of digressing into this conversation and commentary of whether or not it's going to be intelligently designed. And there are guidelines and safeties in place to make sure that this kind of thing doesn't happen. So as far as the drainage goes, we don't know if there's a spring on site. Nobody knows that. It's not definitive. There's going to be a hydrologic study. There's going to be engineering done. It's in our best interest as a city, and it's in the developer's best interest to not have those kind of water problems. It's going to be addressed, I promise.
Very good. Well said. Thank you. So, yeah, that's the line we're trying to toe here. It's a balance of respecting public input and addressing those concerns because they are bona fide. But, yes, let's remember this is a preliminary subdivision plat, and as Commissioner Sikorski said, all of this has to be addressed. It has to. It's not something that's negotiable. So, and anything else on the detention pond?
One quick question.
You know, on the play area for the community and all that.
Correct. That's what I was going to ask about. Okay. We know through engineering that the detention pond has to meet the size for the 100-year flood. If that can't happen, then the development can't happen. So, are there any plans to add play area? What type of landscaping are we talking about? Are we throwing out natural grasses and just letting that go? Or is it going to be lawn? What's going in the detention pond?
So, the bottom of it, you've got to keep clear. So, it would be grasses.
Okay, like natural grasses or like manicured lawn?
Manicured lawn,
okay.
And when it comes out to, I think that's Trimble Creek Road, similar. That'll be a sodded area, and we would do that. I think there was a concern earlier on at your pre-meeting that, you know, sometimes people don't take care of this. And one of the reasons is that, you know, it's just a big area and they've got to pay for landscaping. And this is a condition to our approval. We are putting landscaping in so that person doesn't really have to, oh, what do I do? It's already there. He just has to maintain it and keep a sprinkler going.
Now, will that be managed by the homeowner or, like, of that piece that goes around?
Yeah. In a lot of our subdivisions, you know, back in the late 2000s, we tried to put HOAs on everything. And there was a consistent issue with HOAs where the residents didn't want to be a part of them, especially in situations like this where they're just taking care of a small portion of their neighbor's yard. And so the trend has changed, which is similar to what we are doing. We actually get a premium for selling a larger lot, and he builds his home, and he has a tremendous lot for his personal use. To touch on the issue that was brought up earlier, it's tough to have an area like that and make it kind of more of a global for use. It's tough for us to do it in one subdivision.
Understandable. Well, and that could create problems if you put a playset or something on that lot, and then in community used it, if it's that person's lot, someone got injured, then there's all sorts of problems down the line. So right. I understand that.
Great, thank you. Anything else water related from anyone? Great, let's move to traffic, parking. We talked about garbage trucks. We talked about vehicles being parked on the side, basically making it a one-way street. Would you like to speak to that?
I think the only thing I would say is that the city's done a good job about planning this area for low density. And the impact of this property isn't much based on the 2.7 units per acre. If I were here seeking a rezone for 4 or 5 units per acre, I think traffic starts to become a problem. Now, that doesn't mean that when somebody drives out on that road that they're going to experience a few more cars. We all do that in all of our subdivisions or all of our communities. 90th is a state road. Sometimes it's tough to dictate what you do on 90th. There was some comments about that. But we feel like the flow is the best we can do, and the density is low enough to where the impact would be negligible on residents around.
Great, thank you. Commissioner Sikorski.
Thank you. Also, just as by question, where the private lane connects in, there was comments made earlier about either a turnaround or balusters at the end of that road. My understanding is that at the end of that road, there's going to be balusters that are locked, but that can be removed by the fire department should a fire truck need to come down that road. Because the balusters are removable, that does meet the requirement for a through street for fire trucks, but would not include garbage truck or anything like that. Is that correct?
That's correct. The reason we have that requirement is because with this development and the demolition and the construction of the new homes, they took out the original cul-de-sac that gave us the turnaround on 1150. This was kind of our compromise that allows us to come down 1150 and be able to exit it without having to have a hammerhead or something taking up space along the street itself. The bollards, there was concern about people accessing the 90th along 1150. That was a compromise in putting the bollards in where we restrict access, but still allows us, if we do come down from the north onto the road, that we can get out without having to turn around somebody's driveway.
Thank you.
Commissioner Hatch.
I'm just going to revisit the 90th South entrance. In preparation for tonight, I went out to the site and looked at where this was and went to get back on 90th South, and there were cars parked or trucks parked on both sides, and it was a one-lane road. So I appreciate what the residents are saying as far as traffic, and I don't know if this is a city issue, a development issue, but I agree with the residents. There is a concern with traffic entering 90th South.
And we don't have our traffic engineer here this evening, but of course this will go through a traffic study. Mr. Johnson, do you have anything to add to that, in addition that there was talk of a light at 1075 West and 90th South?
There has been a discussion with the city. Again, the city engineer, the traffic engineer of the city would be the best one to talk about that subject. Traffic and parking-wise, on the road next to the apartments there, that's something, again, that we can look into more heavily, but would not necessarily be directly affected by this project.
Thank you. Commissioner Sikosky.
Thank you. And in line with that same comment, and this may be for Mr. Langford or Mr. Johnson, what's the way to work out, because 90 South is a state road, it's UDOT, who would be responsible, and what do you know what the process would be for trying to get a light at that intersection? Would you have to go through UDOT?
Yes, that would have to go through UDOT and have to meet the traffic warrant.
So for a public information, if they wanted a light there, they would need to petition UDOT more than they would need to petition the city. Is that correct?
It would likely be a joint project.
Okay. So information here, but also for you guys that want that light, start screaming at UDOT, because I think, squeaky wheel gets the grease.
And if I could also add, we do have our city traffic engineer, and as Mr. Johnson's indicated, this likely be a joint project, and oftentimes when you have a city behind a citizen's group, you'll get through the UDOT red tape a little bit quicker. So feel free to contact our department. We can help you with that.
Great, thank you. Anything else dealing with traffic? Commissioner Luthien.
Correct me if I'm wrong, but I seem to understand a little differently than that. It's less that they want light, more that they want safe sidelines, and they want to have two-way traffic. The one-way traffic was really the scary part, with the sidelines of getting in and out of that apartment.
I think it's both. Because I wrote down the light from at least two people. Okay. So I think it's both.
Great. Moving along, there was an issue, well, a few residents mentioned it, the wildlife. I don't know how much the city gets into wildlife. Commissioner Sikosky.
Thank you. This is a delicate situation because nobody wants to hurt animals. But we, I think, also have to remember that every single one of our homes where we live now was once where wildlife was. And not that we're trying to encourage pushing wildlife out, but at the same time, if someone owns a piece of property and they choose to develop that piece of property, then that is their right. And according to land law, you really can't dictate that they can't build on the property because there's wildlife there. So where you have this nice little riparian zone with the water and everything to the east of the project, I think the animals are going to find their way to a habitat that's going to work with them. So, not trying to sound like a jerk, even though I sound like one by saying this, but the wildlife doesn't really have a lot of right in this instance.
Right. I love visiting Wheeler Farm every spring, feeding the ducks.
There you go.
And it's true that the rights of the property owner, of course, trying to balance with the rights of the adjacent property owners, and that's always a tough conundrum. Any other comment on that issue?
No, we'll come back.
All right. Next item was basically materials. Again, this is going to go through the design review committee, and there are mandated materials that need to be used not only on homes, but even fencing. You know, we showed some examples of Rhino Rock there. It's not going to be anything with a chain link. And would you like to speak to any, again, this is preliminary subdivision plat, so just briefly on any thoughts on materials.
Mr. Chair, before he does, sorry to cut you off, just to clarify for the record, this does not go through design review. This is all standard R112 subdivision. If it was a planned community, then yes, your comments would be accurate. But this is a standard single-family residential subdivision. We do have minimum masonry requirements for all single-family homes in West Jordan, which they would have to comply with. But as far as extra requirements, the city code does not have that for this particular development.
Thank you for setting me straight. Appreciate that.
I was going to touch on that, followed up by we will record CCNRs on this, as we do all of our subdivisions. And that will, include, you know, some of these things that we're talking about, including how to take care of that detention pond and who's responsible for it and all those sort of things. So it will be a recorded document.
Great, thank you. And that was the next item. I think we've cleared that up.
I was going to mention they don't have to set up CCNRs the way I read 14.3.9. So if they do, that's of their own volition. But as a city, we cannot require it. Do I read the ordinance correctly?
That's my understanding. Okay. I guess the only caveat would be if we get down to the final design,
right,
and it's determined that an HOA needs to take care of the detention pond, then we would go
right.
Right, and there'll still be code enforcement from the city on the detention pond and the landscaping. That was another issue. So. Great. Anything else that you'd like to speak on, Mr. Holland? I think then the last item, did we cover both the wall? Was there a question on the wall that I missed?
No.
There was that, I didn't fully understand it, to be flat out honest with you. There was a comment about a 7-foot wall.
I think there's a wall.
If you look at 1075, I think it's 1075 West, right in front of the apartment complex, the grade drops. And I'm assuming that I'm following the comments, but there's a retaining wall that runs along the west side of that that road next to the apartments. And because the grade drops, there's a pretty high retaining wall. So I'm not sure what can be done with that. That's needed to support the adjacent property. And I did a quick measurement. That particular public road is 50 feet wide of right-of-way. That's a standard width for our city streets. So in regard to the one-way travel lanes, the only way that we could handle that, it would be the no parking signs. But that would be addressed through the city traffic engineer.
Okay.
Great, thank you. And Mr. Murray and Mr. Langford, do you have anything to interject with the homeowners association paperwork that was tendered to you?
Oh, yes.
Yeah, so a quick look at this. I mean, it's a right-of-way agreement between different private landowners. I mean, it's between, on the one side, the Bachman Abstract and Tile Company, and then several landowners on the other side. But so the city is not a party. So, of course, the city is not bound in any way by this agreement. So, although presumably if someone wanted to enforce their rights, they could encourage that the city do one thing or another during the subdivision process, but the city is not bound.
Thank you.
So, my follow-up on that, if we're talking about an easement that goes into this particular property, the Trimbles could give up their right to that easement. Is it actually listed as an easement? Can they give up that right? This isn't an in perpetuity that they have to maintain that easement.
Yeah, I mean, it creates a joint right-of-way over and across certain properties. And so, presumably, I mean, you would need both sets of parties to agree to something new. Because they each have a property right. It's a joint property right. It's a joint right-of-way easement is what it is. So,
great.
So that's going to have to be negotiated between the property owners to resolve that right-of-way.
Yeah, and their understanding of the agreement was that at some point in time, of course, back then it was Salt Lake County. It was not within the city limits at that time. But it says at the very end of the agreement that the parties agree to join in the dedication of the right-of-way to Salt Lake County, you know, when development occurs. And, of course, development did not occur right away. But that was part of the intent of their agreement as well, was to eventually turn it over, dedicate it to the county. So, gives a little guidance there. This was intended to be a temporary measure until such time as it became a county road.
Thank you. Did you have anything else, Commissioner Gray?
No.
Thank you.
I have one question along those lines. The comment was made in the public hearing session that if there wasn't a turnabout or something, then we're voiding some sort of contract. But with the removable balusters, bollards, that wouldn't impinge any kind of obstruction, because fire can still come down that road, and it doesn't change anything. The status quo remains the same, because right now they have trouble with garbage access, etc. So it kind of becomes a moot point. Am I correct in assuming that?
One could make that argument. Obviously I can't speak for these two sets of parties. One could argue that there's some other part of this agreement that doesn't carry on. But, normally what happens in the subdivision process is all the property owners come to some kind of agreement that gets placed on the plat, and everybody agrees that the plat has everything within it, and it supersedes anything prior. And so we would hope that those parties would come together, resolve their concerns. If the fire and public safety access is the sole reason that they agree upon that, then great. If there's another issue or two, they really ought to resolve those and come to the city and say, hey, these issues we've resolved in this manner. And then if they work with the developer to make sure it ends up on the plat, that really is the perfect way to resolve this. But the city is not required to be a mediator or anything else. These are private property issues that need to be worked out.
I just want to make sure that as the city, our primary concerns are the health and welfare.
Yes, okay, got right. So yeah, the primary city issue would be the fire access, and that would be resolved by the proposed situation, with it being available for through traffic for fire, with the bollards preventing other traffic. The only question remains, does that resolve all the issues of the private property owners? But that's not our concern.
That's not our
concern. Our concern is resolved, you're right.
Thank you.
Thank you. Commissioner Luthy.
Was there, obviously, if that road went through, it seems like it would alleviate some of the problems of getting onto 90th. What was the holdup on not making that part of the subdivision roads instead of just putting the bollards at the end and capping it off? Why was that not up for...
Good question. It's a private road currently.
Right.
And so what we didn't want to do is get into, you know, to get my subdivision to go out that way, the city would probably require a full city right-of-way. And that would take out a lot of front yards and cause a lot of improvements to happen on that road.
Great, thank you. Any final comments, Mr. Holland?
No.
Anything from staff? Great, thank you. Let's bring it back to the commission for deliberation, ultimately leading to a recommendation. Commissioner Green.
So I'm looking at the, it's in the staff report, but I'm looking at 1437, the findings for approval for a subdivision plat. And we have to find four things. One, that is consistent with the city general plan. And I'm going to go on record that these houses, and as big as they are consistent with the general plan. Here's the conundrum that I have with the second finding. It says the proposed site has adequate access to public streets and highways to carry the type and quantity of traffic which may be generated by the subject use, and that there's adequate to permit movement in a manner which is safe and efficient. This is zoned R112, so we're talking about a smaller number of homes than we would be talking about if this were an R10 or an R18, which would exponentially increase the traffic. I do have a concern with 1075 West. Yeah. And I think that my concern with 1075 West may not be with this subdivision, but it may be with the apartment complex and the fact that there may not be adequate parking at the parking complex. The apartment complex there at River Oaks, and that's why they're all parking on the street. I don't know how we address that. Maybe you can give us an idea on how, think about that one for a second, and then see the public facilities intended to serve the development, including the stormwater drainage systems and water supplies and all that other stuff, are adequate to serve the site. I'm not sure I've been convinced yet that adding a new drain line and that one to Hidden Peak will be enough to drain the water. I know that there's the minimum code, but I'm concerned. We've seen the cost with what we thought was the code, and 70th South's been under repair for 2 years now because of the inadequate stormwater between the river and 32nd West. So I'm concerned there that doesn't meet that, and that's where I'm sitting. But when it comes to the 1075 West, what can be done? There's nothing we can do about the retaining wall, but can we as a city deal with the parking on both sides of the street, or is our ordinance as such that people can park on both sides of the street, or can we declare that no parking zone? What's the city's authority at that point in time to deal with the street?
The city has the ability to restrict parking out on the roadway with no parking zones.
Okay. Or make extra money and just charge a lot for parking, one of the two.
Thank you. Commissioner Luthy.
I'm assuming that there will be a traffic impact study with this next portion. Is that the case? So that there will be actual data to back up this is a problem or not a problem?
I have not been the review engineer on this particular project, but subdivisions of this size typically do not require a traffic impact study.
I feel like we might need to add that to the conditions.
Mm-hmm. Great point.
So I'm going to play devil's advocate. What happens to traffic if we make that a condition and they do the traffic impact study and it says the roads aren't adequate enough, that we can't find, and I don't think we can find that tonight to say, yeah, it's good enough under the findings for approval until we've seen that data.
But is that something, the second devil's advocate, is that something that you do at a preliminary site plan?
No, it is not. Well, this we're not. We're only going to have the. We're only going to have the preliminary. We're going to do the subdivision. This subdivision plat. We'll never see the final.
That's correct.
So our only shot at this is tonight, because if we approve it, we're done. And if not, because this doesn't even go to the city council.
No, it does not.
But I, can I just interject real fast? That if we approve it tonight, it still has to meet all the standards. It still has to fall into all of the code requirements. It still has to hit everything.
Right,
now, you've used two examples of potentially stalling the project based upon an intersection flow that's not on site or doesn't have anything to do with the data for this site, and you've also used describing the traffic that's up by the apartments. Now, I'm not trying to, the point is that those things, while they do have factor into this, don't necessarily have, it doesn't deal directly with this site. So I'm having a little bit of a hard time seeing that we use those as examples to
But I disagree, because it says the proposed site has adequate access to public streets and highways to carry the type and quantity of traffic which may be generated.
Which it would have to do. Well, it would have to pass the traffic study.
But there is no, but there's no traffic study required. So if there's no traffic study required, well, if we say these roads are good enough, those roads are good enough.
Okay. However,
there's no standard
road. The roads that tie into this actual site do fit the standard. The problem is up by the apartments there, right? Which is a problem with the apartments, and it's a problem with code enforcement or traffic design on that section, which is off of this site. And I do understand that what you're saying is that you have concern that there's problem there. However, the problem is not because of road width, because the road width meets the standard of the city. The problem is with the way that we have signage and allow parking for that section that is not part of this site. So where it is important to address that section, I don't believe personally that it's appropriate to stall this project based on the fact that some other off-site entity is having traffic problems within the city.
Well, but you've got to have adequate access to streets.
You do.
Now, if we decide to find, and I haven't completely made my decision yet, if we decide to find that the other two outlets provide adequate access, then we can make that finding. But I think that there are three ingress egress points to the neighborhood. Mm-hmm. We have to find that that those ingress egress points provide adequate access in and out. And if the one that goes to Trimble, whatever the heck it is, Trimble Creek Drive, is not adequate, then maybe the whole development doesn't have enough adequate, you know, if we say 33% of it doesn't need it, we may not have adequate access. And that's my point, is that we've got three ingress and egresses, but I tend to agree with Commissioner Luthi. This is one of those that I'm not sure that we have enough traffic data, and normally the neighborhood doesn't support it, and is that something that we want to do? I haven't made my decision yet, but that's a question. Do we want to do that?
Okay, let me ask you this, though, and I'm sorry. If the road itself going out on 1150 there is the adequate width, if it's the size that the city dictates is the adequate width for this type of subdivision, and signage is the only thing that's stopping this traffic from going through, then we do have adequate traffic access. What we have a problem with is signage for that apartment structure.
Which I agree with. I agree with. And I agree that that is a city-based decision. I completely agree. What I don't agree with is that is the access to 90th South. You can't end your access as it just leaves the new part of your little development.
Okay.
You have to look at how it gets to the main city.
Totally, and that's fair.
But I do agree that is a West Jordan city complication.
But let me ask
and
you
I
this.
See where you're going. Let me ask you're you this. The road
is it our right to deny a builder or a developer access to his property because we have a problem with one of our streets?
I think that it is our right to ask for a traffic study.
And that's fair. I'm fine with that.
That's what I am proposing, is that it gets added in there.
As part of the line item.
That they need to do a traffic study to decide whether or not it is a hindrance, because if it does give you only two exits out of the neighborhood, it may not be sufficient, which is what I believe you were trying to say.
But if we say that we need a traffic study, then we can't just approve this and say it's a condition, because
what we can say is if the traffic study comes through and meets adequate, then it can still go through the city's planning office, as long as the traffic study pans out. But we don't need to see that.
But I don't think we can abdicate our responsibility to the city staff.
Commissioner Lucey, did you have anything else?
No, I was just
fine. Thank you. So, Mr. Murray, any potential problem with adding that condition on this particular item?
No, I mean, you clearly have the authority under each of the findings to make sure that they're met. And it sounds to me like you're focused on finding B.
That's one.
And at least one of the findings you're focused on. And you're looking at, is there adequate access to public streets and highways to carry the type and quantity of traffic and so forth. So, and the vehicular and pedestrian circulation. And so basically what the focus or the scope of your traffic study would be is to come back and tell you, is that met or not? Because obviously you can't make a fully informed decision if you feel like you're missing information and you're trying to find the rest of the information so that you can make that fully informed decision. I would just make sure that in whatever eventual motion you have, you're specifically identifying which findings that you're concerned about and want the traffic study to cover.
Agreed.
But if we said, and this will go back to a delegation of authority. If we say something that Commissioner Sikorski just suggested and said, if the traffic study is determined adequate, then it can move forward, are we delegating our obligation to the staff, because then the staff is the one that has to make that determination where initially on the preliminary, that's our job to determine that, and can we actually delegate that authority by asking for a traffic study and then saying the staff can make that decision at the end?
Yeah, and I think from your past history, you've done it before, so you could do it. I mean, really what it is there's some line at some point that you determine as a planning commission that you draw, and there are minor, more insignificant items where you defer to staff on. If it's something of major consequence, you might decide that you're on the other side of the line and really you ought to make that decision. So you're just making a determination. How big is it? Minor, give it to staff to pass it conditionally. Major, get the study first and make the decision later.
Great, thank you. Let's please hear from Commissioner Hassan.
Thank you. I'm assuming that this road that comes off of 90th, along the apartments is not a private road, it's a public road. And I'm assuming also there's not curb, gutter, sidewalk, that type of thing. We've got a 50-foot right of way, but I don't believe there's sidewalk. And
there is.
On both sides?
There is.
Even though I agree with Commissioner Sikorski, that road is not attached to this development. It does give access, but it isn't part of this development. Is there any way the city could put up signs, no parking on the west side of the road, paint the curb red, do anything like that would prevent parking on the west side of the road, which would allow for two-way traffic? Mr. Johnson.
The city can certainly look into that. I do not know at this particular moment all of the details that would be involved in that, but that is something that we could address separately.
Thank you.
Thank you. Commissioner Sikorski.
Thank you. And this is just a question for the commission. Let me ask you this. If we had a traffic study done today, and the traffic study said that the traffic was adequate and it could go through, would that sway your opinion?
Mm-hmm.
So, that being said, if we say in our motion that a traffic study needs to be done, and a traffic study needs to be positive that, yes, traffic will be adequate for this to go forward. Make that a condition of the motion. Yes, make that a condition of the motion. Would that be sufficient? Because at that point, to answer your question earlier, would we be deferring our authority and responsibility to staff? I believe that we would be at that point, because our opinion is that we would want the traffic study to be done, and that it would be a positive, yes, it will work. And if we would have accepted that here today as okay and sufficient, then by saying that as a part of our motion, then we're essentially doing the same thing. We're just saying that it has to be done, and it has to be found that it will work for this to go forward.
But if we haven't seen it, how do we know it's good? I mean, what are we defining as positive traffic study would be?
You just said a second ago that if the traffic study was done and they said that it was positive, that you would accept that.
Yeah, I would, but I'm just trying to figure out what the depth is.
So that's the baseline.
Okay. The other question, I mean, obviously, there's a whole ton of people that are worried about water over here, and standing water and springs. And has there been any hydrology report done at all on this piece of property?
Just the geo.
That has not yet been submitted to the city.
See, and that's where I have the concern, is that if the city, you're an engineer, you know there's water everywhere, and groundwater and all those other kind of things, that if we haven't seen a hydrology report to know what we need to do to fix the stormwater system, and I'm not an engineer, so if we haven't seen that, how do we know that it's adequate to service this neighborhood unless we're guessing? I mean, do we have any, because we don't have any idea of how much water is going in we're going to build that extension, and we've got the existing one. Do we have enough data to say that current existing system will handle the houses in this particular area?
You're correct in that there is not enough information right now. Until this is further studied, there isn't an engineering solution. I believe that the developer is waiting to get approval for this preliminary element before doing the final design, and the final design will incorporate the things that you mentioned.
Thank you. Commissioner Luthi.
I think the hydrology report will speak well to how much water is going to go into the pipes and how much the pond needs to be sized. However, it will not identify this groundwater spring discussion that we've had from the beginning. That's a separate issue, and any hydrology report wouldn't even touch that. So I think that we may need to add in one of the conditions the same idea that needs to be investigated and figured out exactly what's causing that. And maybe it is just that it was the irrigation, the flooding that was of the irrigation of the entire site, and maybe with that being closed off, that's not the problem. But whatever is the problem, it needs to be investigated enough so that that's solved, because that won't be identified in a hydrology report.
Right.
I've written a lot, and that's not the case.
I'm just wondering if with what we have, if we can make a positive finding that the services are adequate to serve the site, and I'm not convinced of that yet.
Commissioner Spassky.
Thank you. Again, being a licensed professional myself, it's in the best interest of the engineer to make sure that their information is correct, because if this site goes through, let's say everything goes through and 15 homes flood, then whoever's stamp is on that plan is going to have a lot of liability. And so I agree with Commissioner Luthi in that I think it's good for us to add perhaps something to the motion that states that we need a hydrologic study that includes study to see if there actually is a spring on the site, and what that would entail to mitigate. But as far as our due diligence, because of the process that the city has, I feel like we can summarily state that yes, as long as the study is complete and it's positive, then we have put forth our best foot, because I'm not an engineer, and I'm going to rely on a professional to determine whether or not that site is developable. So as long as we require that, then I would be comfortable in putting my okay on that.
But being the devil's advocate, we've seen what happens with certain engineers stamping their project and how much money that's cost the city the last couple of 3 years.
And as devil's advocate again, I'm not an engineer, so I couldn't back up what they say. I couldn't check into it deep enough to say that they're wrong.
Okay, all you devils, let's hear from an angel. All right. Commissioner Hanson.
Thank you. The problem on 70th South, just to clear things up, was not our problem to begin with. It came from West Jordan. And then we got that property and it became our problem. But it did start, with Kearns. And so that's where that problem started. It did create a large problem on 70th South and 3200 West. Those people, I felt so bad for them. I mean, they couldn't even drive in their driveways. The water was so high. But it did, it was, if not Kearns, a Salt Lake County problem to begin with. And then we inherited it.
Great, good discussion, everyone. Would anyone like to take a try at a motion?
Before you do that, I do have one comment, but before we vote. There's a couple of things that I want to make sure that, because I'm still not decided which way I'm going to do it. I like the fact that we have R112 here, and it's consistent with the current zone. So I don't, the difficulty with this is that it's not a rezone. This property's been zoned that way for probably several years. And so putting this number of homes on here is not unexpected. It shouldn't be a surprise. And I'll let somebody else make the motion while I think what I want to do.
Commissioner Sikorski.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Chair, real quick, just as a point of consideration, it would help staff, if we decide to move forward today, if you look at condition number 3, we talk about the treatment of the detention basin on lot 101. It says the detention basin on lot 101 shall be fully landscaped. If we could get some clarity that it'll be with turf grass and that there will be a permanent underground automatic irrigation system installed with that, that way we know that it'll be taken care of. If we just throw down sod and then the homeowner is obligated to put all that irrigation in, chances are it won't, and it'll become a maintenance eyesore to the community.
Great point, thank you. We talked about what type of landscape, but yes, we don't want to overly burden the homeowner. So we have 3 major conditions we discussed: water, traffic, and the basin.
Yep, got it. Okay.
Please, Commissioner Sikorski.
Thank you. Based on the findings set forth in the staff report and on evidence and explanations received today, I move that the Planning Commission approve the preliminary subdivision plat for the Trimble Manor subdivision located at approximately 9191 South, 1150 West, with the conditions set forth in the staff report, with one amendment to the staff recommendations that the detention basin on lot 101 shall be fully landscaped with turf grass and a permanent irrigation system, as well as 2 additional conditions, one being that a hydrologic study will be completed to include the determination of whether or not a spring does in fact exist upon the site, and if it does in fact exist, that mitigation will be made to the effect of summarily rectifying that problem. Also, a traffic study needs to be done, and if the traffic study needs to be a positive recommendation in order for the subdivision to go forward.
Can I insert something into that?
Please.
I think we need to specify exactly about that traffic study, that it needs to include all of that.
Okay,
that road
the traffic road. Study will include all of, is that 1150
I don't
west?
Know, I think I forgot.
1175 west.
1075
west.
Perfect,
just write that down.
Thank you. The traffic study will include all of 1075 west to 90th south.
Perfect, thank you.
Great. Is there a second to the motion?
Go back over the hydraulic. Were there two parts or just one? The spring? Are we also going to deal with the size of the stormwater pipe? I'm just asking.
I feel comfortable that the staff is able to size the stormwater pipe. I am concerned about the spring and the mitigation of the spring. Not to mention that if it is a spring, that you're dealing with protection of the spring in some form because it's
which will all fall out in the hydraulic study.
So we need to make sure that that is accordingly addressed.
Mr. Chairman, you probably ought to have a second before you have further discussion.
Thank you. Is there a second to Commissioner Sikorski's current motion?
Second.
Great. Then discussion of the motion, just to clarify, staff recommendation number one stays as written, the same with number two. Number three.
Number two was amended.
Number three was amended. Four stands as written, five stands as written, six stands as written. Commissioner Sikorski is adding all things water on seven. That's the hydrological study. And then there's an eighth condition, which deals with traffic. So there's eight total
conditions. Correct.
Great. Any other discussion to this motion? Let's vote. All in favor say aye.
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 Any opposed?
No.
Motion carries 5-1 in favor, with Commissioner Green casting the dissenting vote. Thank you. Thank you for an in-depth discussion. And thank you again, residents, for all of your input. This brings us to item number 7 on our agenda this evening. Oker Tire and Service, 5970 West, Dan and Way, conditional use permits. Ryan Fuller is the applicant. Is he present this evening? Good luck making your way down. 5 seconds. Hurry.
Adam Nash is here too on the Westwood thing.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks for your patience, Ms. Larson.
She was hoping she'd bail out of here early, didn't she? She's just getting overtime.
Hello, Mr. Fuller.
Ryan Fuller, 5970 West Dannanway, West Jordan is our property location. And I sat back here, it was my first time at a commission meeting, and I was a little disappointed there was no Commissioner Gordon. With no disrespect due to those on the supporting here. But we are proposing that we would like to do a tire and service shop at our location out there on Dannanway. And I think we would be, there we go. We would think, where's that pointer? There. I think that we fall underneath the correct specifications for the zoning, with the exception, I think there's a well that the city dug over in this area. Could have been a mistake, but we're inside that circle now. So that's why we're here today.
Great, thank you. And just one moment, please. Mr. Langford, did the gentleman get back his original copies? He's just barely leaving right now. Okay, thank you. Wonderful.
Oh, and one more thing, could I say thanks to Mr. McCallison, Mr. Forsyth. Oh, he's gone. But Mr. Forsyth, too, for helping us get this far in the process. Much appreciated.
Great. Always good to give thanks. Thank you, sir. And this is Mr. Forsyth.
Thank you, Chairman. So, as the applicant said, they're just going to be operating an auto repair business inside the existing warehouse there, as shown on the site. All operations, as has been explained by the applicant, are going to be placed within inside the building. There won't be any outdoor storage of materials or chemicals or anything like that. Particularly since this permit doesn't necessarily cover that, and because the applicant wouldn't be able to make the necessary improvements at this time. So So for right now, they're just covering the auto repair business within the well water protection zone. So this well water protection zone is a 250-day time of travel protection zone, meaning that it takes 250 days for groundwater to reach that aquifer. And so as part of that, city code does require that a conditional use permit go before the planning commission to discuss that and make sure there's no adverse impacts. Other than that, the remaining area, it's all zoned M1, light industrial, and we feel that this business would be appropriate for the area, given that pretty much all the businesses in there are similar in nature and impact. The engineering department's reviewed the plans, and it's basically determined that because this is in an existing warehouse, that the site has the needed improvements to contain any accidental spills, and with the conditional use permit, that should there should be adequate conditions to mitigate that in the event of both of a spill and to ensure that best practices are followed. So. The fire department's also looked at it. Really, the only concerns they had were sprinkler systems, which the building does have, and those will be inspected when during the business license inspection by the fire department. Their other concern was tires, but the applicant has said most of their tires will be stored off-site. They'll only have a few on-site for just on hand in case of needed repairs and things like that. So based on these findings and those explained in the staff report, staff is recommending that the Planning Commission grant approval of the conditional use permit for Ochre Tire and Service located at 5970 West Inn and Wing with the conditions of approval listed in the staff report.
Thank you, Mr. Forsyth. Mr. Brockbank, anything else on that? You were looking a little surprised that
it woke me up. No, most of our concerns with the original concern was the amount of tires that were going to be in there, and tires burn at a completely different rate than normal combustibles. So I had some concern about how many tires we were going to be storing inside. Does it have anything to do with the CUP or anything like that? As Mr. Forsyth said, we'll deal with those issues at the business license inspection.
Great, thank you. Commissioner Luthi.
More just a curiosity, how many tires are allowed?
Four.
Four, so
no, I don't know.
Oh, there's not a limit that no. Say this is still considered a...
No, what we have to do is each tire puts out a certain type of BTU, mm-hmm. and then we add up all those BTUs, and then we take that and make calculations with the fire sprinkler system, and can the system put out X number of tires, and that would be the limit number of tires.
So you will put an official limit, this is the amount of tires?
If they plan on storing inside. Okay. I haven't had a chance to talk with them about it. But
mostly curiosity on my part.
There you go.
Great, thank you. Any other questions for staff from the commission? Commissioner Green.
So this site, is it all concrete?
No, only part of the site is developed.
Oh, it's just hard to tell from the photo, that's why I asked.
Yeah, so if you can see it's kind of hard to tell from here, but the dark brown area surrounding the building, that's all paved parking surface. Everything outside of that is dirt, so undeveloped.
Any other questions for staff? Well, this was noticed as a public hearing, so we'll open the public hearing for any residents who would like to speak. We have two that have signed up. Mr. Fuller, did you have anything else that you wanted to say, or was that just redundant from your initial comments? Thank you. We have Ben Spalding.
That was redundant also.
Okay. Hey, we're just happy to have you. Anyone else who would like to speak on this item this evening? Seeing none, we'll close the public comment section and bring it back for conversation amongst the commissioners. Commissioner Sikorski.
Thank you. Well, based on the positive findings set forth in the staff report, I recommend that the Planning Commission approve the conditional use permit for auto repair operations within the drinking water source protection overlay for Oker Tire and Service located at 5970 West Gannon Way in the M1 zone with the following conditions that are set forth in the staff report.
Second.
We have a motion from Commissioner Sikorski and a second from Commissioner Luthy. Any discussion to that motion? All in favor say aye.
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 Any opposed?
No.
Motion carries unanimously 6-0, which brings us to our final item, item number 4 on the agenda this evening, Westwood Subdivision, 7904 through 7930 South, 2700 West, preliminary subdivision plat, 12 lots on 3.1 acres in an R18E zone. Growth Aid LLC, Adam Nash is the applicant. Good to see you, sir.
It's Adam Nash, 4376 South, 700 East in Salt Lake City. I apologize for being a few minutes late, and you guys taught me why I shouldn't do that. We'll let that happen again. We worked with staff, come up with a plan that we think is really appropriate. We acquired this property late last summer. Had some intention of trying to pursue some kind of a multifamily or what you might think could get behind a shopping center on a busy road, but adhering to the city's wishes, we chose to go ahead and pursue R1 zone. It was zoned R110, some performance zone that the city used to use in the 80s and 90s, and that zone wasn't appropriate anymore, so we came in with a request for the R18. The lots themselves average just above 9,000 square feet, but it allowed us to have a configuration with frontage and setbacks so that we could fit the subdivision the way that we wanted to, and also to preserve two homes that are on 2700 West. We were able to fit those within the requirements in the R18 zone that we could not have in the R110. The subzone that we're asking for is E. D, E, G?
Yeah, the house size is E size zone.
E. Mm-hmm. And we work with staff to assure them that we can fit those homes on all of these lots. They're a challenge to the lots in the deep part of the cul-de-sac, but our architects and engineers at Graphic Services have provided plans to the city that show that we have plans readily available to us that we can fit on those that will meet the requirements of the city, as well as our requirements that we expect in this subdivision. So, really excited to get going on this, and hopefully you guys are too.
Great, thank you. And no worries, we were here anyway, but I think that Ms. Larson deserves a Cafe Rio gift certificate or something.
She'll get it.
Okay. Commissioner Sikorski.
Thank you. One of the things that we discussed in the previous item, as well as in our pre-meeting, is we talked about the detention pond on the front of, I think it's
number 8.
Number 8. So one of the concerns that we have is so many times these detention ponds, even though they've been basically deeded to the homeowner there with the easement for the city to be able to come in and clean those out, so many times the homeowner will fence those off and just kind of let them go, turn to weeds and such. One of the conditions that we talked about was potentially making sure that plat is recorded as an easement, but also that the detention pond be maintained and landscaped by the homeowner, and that would be a requirement put in with the understanding that homeowner would have to do that.
That's our understanding.
Okay.
This is a really, it's not a very big basin. It allows us to collect water at a central point and then control it.
Right.
And also to, the profile of the road is such that there'll be sidewalk curb gutter, then a park curb, then the sidewalk, and then it'll be in the yard. So
right.
It'd be pretty, no, if the homeowner, were to fence it off, and he would be fencing off his own front. frontage and his access into his own subdivision to create that potential problem. So, of course, if you'd like to put that on the plat, we're fine with it. We plan on recording it as an easement and putting exceptional notice on the plat about that as well.
Okay, thank you.
Commissioner Luthi.
Are you planning on putting in the landscaping for that pond itself so that it's already taken care of?
No, it's done with the building permit, and I don't build the homes, but it'll be done with the building permit. They put in a landscaping bond when they pull their permit.
Any other questions for the applicant? Thank you.
Thanks.
Ms. Larson.
Thank you. I think that the applicant covered the proposed preliminary subdivision in West Woods really well. Staff has found in our report that the application meets all four criteria, and staff is recommending that the Planning Commission grant a preliminary major subdivision for West Woods subdivision with the four conditions listed in the staff report.
Thank you. Comments or questions to staff?
In the previous subdivision, the one that we just dealt with, it in one of the conditions is street lights. Is this small enough that doesn't need street lights, or should it have street lights?
Yes, the subdivision will require street lights.
So I guess my question is, why was it a condition on that one and not on this one? Does it make any difference? I'm just wondering.
If engineering is requiring it, typically when I write my staff reports, I don't include the condition if it's already going to be required.
So the streetlights are required by code, so we don't have to worry about it as a condition.
Right, and they're actually shown. I see two lights on the preliminary plat, one at the cul-de-sac and one at the intersection. So.
Thank you. Commissioner Luthi.
Along those same lines, I was looking at the staff recommendations from the previous one, and those 2 through 6 almost seem like they need to be in both places. Is it something that we should just add to it? Is it being redundant? Are you not sure why it would be important for one and not important for both?
Great point. I agree with that.
I feel like it should be, I mean, if it's what we want for one, we should probably take 2 through 6 and tack it on to all of this.
When you say 2 through 6, just to clarify, are you talking about how we...
So 2 talks about detailing the ownership and perpetual maintenance of the proposed detention pond, mm-hmm. which we talked about, meaning you are the plat. 3 talks about that it needs to be fully landscaped, the detention basin. 4 was the street lighting that was just discussed. Wait. 5 talks about the requirements met for all the city departments before recording the plat. And 6 was that all existing and new utilities within the boundary shall be installed underground. I just feel like if it's on one report, it probably should be on.
Do you think item 3 should be amended as well to be with turf grass and a permanent irrigation system?
I think that would go a long way to make it so that we don't have this perpetual problem that I think is going to plague the city.
Although I
think that there's another thing to be said with people that zeroscape it too, so that's the hard part about putting it in one direction or the other, but maybe it needs to be clarified that you can either zeroscape it to meet this requirement, or you can turf-grade it, grass it with a permanent underground, and you can pick between the two.
Yes.
But if you do go with the zeroscape, you need to have appropriate weed filters, and you need to have a maintenance of how often you're going to keep this thing cleaned up, because the other one has a maintenance of how often you have to mow it, so this should have how often you need to go spray it down, or go kick the weeds, or whatever else. But I agree with you, there are property rights, and you should be able to pick between which two options, because both will do the job.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Point.
If I may, too, the size of this detention basin is significantly smaller than the last subdivision that you've reviewed. There's nothing in there that talks about timing, either. The applicants indicated that they're going to record this plat, move forward, they won't be the home builder, if I understood you correctly. I guess if the commission could clarify, if you decide to include condition number 3, the timing of that.
With construction of the home, perhaps,
with construction.
For final occupancy of the home.
You know, engineering, you probably require some sort of improvements or some stabilization to take place. So we may not have construction on lot 108 for years.
That's
but
true.
You still need
but the
to,
lot needs to be existing.
Stabilize the basin. So just throwing that out for some food for thought.
So with that, maybe I can ask engineering, at what point, you know, are we going to need to see that kind of stabilization?
The stabilization will come in with the whole storm drain system. So when the subdivision's put in with the roads, the sewer, the water, everything else, we will have put in the pond.
But, so at that point, I mean, is that when the turf grass would need to go in, or could it...
At that time, it won't have a homeowner with the irrigation system who's paying the bills for the water and all that kind of stuff.
So if this home sits for eight, or this pond sits for 8 years, and let's say every other lot there, except that one, sells, worst case scenario, right? So, I mean, at what point are we going to look at degradation of slope and so forth, because there's no landscaping holding that together.
I guess that's a somewhat open-ended solution or question. I'm not certain I can tell you exactly when it's going to start falling apart if nobody looks at it.
All right.
Even if there's not a home on lot 108, even on the preliminary plat, it does say that the detention basin will be maintained by the property owner of lot 108.
Okay.
So whoever owns it, whether it's a home builder.
So it's the developer's problem until the lot is sold.
It's whoever owns the property.
Okay, that answered my question. Thank you, Ms. Larson.
You want to suspend rules?
Yeah, I'll move to suspend
either that or
rules.
We can open it for everybody. Have we held the public hearing for this yet?
Okay. No. We've got a motion by Commissioner Scott. One moment. I'm sorry, Commissioner Luthy. You have another comment?
That was my comment. Sorry.
Okay. Great. So we have a motion by Commissioner Sukowski to suspend the rules. Do we have a second to the motion?
Second.
Yeah.
Second by Commissioner Hansen. Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Motion unanimous. Mr. Nash.
Sorry, I know that's unusual, but we were privileged to know what items 2-6 are, first of all. So I'm not exactly sure that we understand what you're putting on us. But as I'm listening to it, what might be appropriate for one subdivision is not necessarily appropriate for the other. For instance, we have high-tension power lines that cross us on 2700 West, but by that motion, you would be telling me I have to bury them. So, I mean, you just got to be careful about what you're doing, because staff already knows if it's a 70 whatever kilowatt line and it won't get buried if it's less than that. You guys have ordinances that say that all utilities will be underground. So to say it again might get misinterpreted, and you might be expecting me to bury high tension power lines that are in, it's called pull line road because that's where the pull line goes. And so, you know, you just have to be careful with those things. We're not opposed to any of them. It's just that every project's a little different, and on that last one you were discussing, those were big ponds, potential problems. This is little. This is like half the size of this jury box over here, and it's about this deep.
But we don't have anything showing that. I don't have anything there telling me how deep it is, or how much of that area it's going to take.
Sorry, we provided the flat plans, but also it will be built to standard. It's not just a depression in the dirt. It's actually a built basin, and it retains water on purpose, and there's a valve in it, a discharge mechanism, so that as water piles up, then it's designed to hold it and release it at a certain rate into the street, into the storm drain that is in the street. So I'm just saying, I didn't know what 2-6 was, first of all, and I think everybody's project should stand on its own merit. I don't think every one of them should have all of those lists. There's ordinances and things that we comply with way beyond that list. So that's just my 2 cents worth. But we're happy to do, you know, things that are within reason. It's fine. But it could affect our bonding as well. I mean, there's other things to be considered.
Right, thank you. Yeah, we'll make sure that we're very specific and clear on that. Commissioner Luthy.
Yeah, you're correct. Thank you for that. I completely agree. You are right that you weren't party to what the items were that were on here. Although I do think that several of them do apply and you should include in there. As to the pond, the grand discussion was, I do understand how they operate and everything else. The discussion was aesthetically that a lot of times they are neglected. And so we were trying to discuss aesthetically how to not cause that problem.
I think it's a great discussion because this is now becoming part of state law. And so not just because it's a good idea for us on this little subdivision, this is going to be something the city and all the cities are going to have to deal with continually from this point forward. So I would encourage you to come up with a program of what is required of a developer while we own the lot, while the home is being built, after the home is built, so that it is consistent, if possible. And so, I definitely think that's a problem the city is going to face to a greater extent. This will be every subdivision is going to have this.
Correct. That's what caused the conversation.
Yeah.
Yes, I
detention pond ordinance.
That's what I was just wondering. Do we need a detention pond ordinance, Scott?
I think it needs discussion.
I think you're right.
Before it becomes a real problem.
We have consistent wording in the ordinance.
Because underground is an option as well. We haven't discussed that tonight, but that is an option.
Because of all the options, underground versus surface versus the types of treatment, landscaping, turf, xeriscape. There are a lot of different options. The engineering, they do have some standards. There's nothing in the zoning code that specifies thou shalt do X, Y, Z. It's meant to allow for best practices in a case-by-case scenario. So if anything were to be clarified, it would likely not be in Title 13 or 14. It would be in the engineering design standards. So.
Okay. Very good. Thank you. Any further comment?
No, except for I do want to add that if I own lot 108 in 10 years, the detention basin will still work. The lot will be cut to 6 inches, just like the guy that comes by and gives me a fine about 20 times a year. It'll look like any other lot in a subdivision, but the basin will work. It'll work because that's our agreement with the city. It'll be built to their standard.
Cool. So. Very good. Thank you.
Thank you. Sorry about that.
Great. Let's open up the public hearing portion, if anybody would like to speak on this item. Seeing none, we'll close the public hearing and bring it back to the commission.
I think we need to add at least the one condition that details the ownership and the perpetual maintenance on the final plat. I think that's got to be at least part of it. I don't know if maybe we can do something about being landscaped or in compliance with city code that would deal with both the water cheap way and the water expensive way.
I think maybe if we were to just word it to say, like, the detention pond is to be maintained and landscaped by the homeowner or by the property owner to the city requirements for landscaping. That work?
Can you just say ownership?
Yeah.
The ownership.
Commissioner Luthy?
But does that require that the person that now is going to build on the plot in the meantime has to bring it to some sort of a standard? Are they allowed to just leave it as, you see what I'm saying?
Well, I think the city requirement for a developer is much different than the city requirement for a homeowner, so somebody who's developed the land and has that land for sale would just need to make sure that, for instance, that the drainage box would remain unobstructed and, able to flow, and if for some reason, if grade did degrade, then they would regrade that section.
Can you speak to talk what the requirements are for, like, is it supposed to be the whole bottom's gravelled, or what's the requirements for during development phase?
Okay, that's a great question. For a detention pond, we just need some sort of stabilization, whether it be a cobble, sod, native grasses, something of that nature, but we don't specify what that is. So it could be anything at this point.
When you say stabilization, when does this have to be done?
So the stabilization will happen at least reasonably close to when this is developed. It has to have something which will allow it to be functional. Now, if a homeowner at some later point would like to transform that into sod or something else, they could do that. But the city does not have a requirement for what needs to go in at this point, just as long as it's functional.
Okay, so it will reach at least minimum function, and then perhaps we could put in there that the detention pond, the detention pond should be maintained by the owner at the city requirement. But for landscape.
That needs to be recorded on the plat, that the owner is responsible for the detention pond.
Yeah, right? That's another item.
Because what I want to do is make sure that if this little detention area is the responsibility of the property owner, that the property owner can't come in 6-8 months later and say, I didn't know about it or whatever. That you always see happen. I think we just need to put the property owner on fair notice by making sure that that's on the plat and that they're responsible for the maintenance. And if the stabilization is required by the city and the property never sells, then you're stuck with maintaining the piece, like what Ms. Larson said. The developer or the property owner, whoever owns the property at the time, is going to be stuck with making sure that it's maintained and with code enforcement type stuff.
Great, thank you. Commissioner Sapowski.
Okay, based on the positive findings set forth in the staff report and information received during this meeting, I move that the Planning Commission approve Westwood's preliminary subdivision plat for the property located at 7904, 7906, 7930 South, 2700 West, in an R1 8E zoning district with the conditions set forth in the staff report and including two additional conditions. One is that the easement for the detention pond shall be recorded on the plat as owner maintained, and also that the detention pond will be maintained by the owner at the landscape city requirements.
Right, conditions 5 and 6.
Correct.
Is there a second to that motion?
I'll second.
Great. A motion from Commissioner Sikorski and a second from Commissioner Hansen. Any discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries unanimously, 6-0. Thank you for doing business in West Jordan. This brings us to the end of our agenda this evening.
Move to adjourn.
We have a motion to adjourn. Any discussion? All right, we stand adjourned for 2 weeks. Thank you.